This video is sponsored by Best Buy. On December 5th, 2022 at 1:03 a.m., the Lawrence Livermore Laboratory and its National Ignition Facility reached a milestone they've been after for nearly 60 years. They produced the first nuclear fusion ignition in history. But what does that mean exactly, and what does it imply for nuclear fusion? Is it a major breakthrough that some claim, or just a milestone along a long path? And most importantly, what does it mean for you and me? I'm Ricky, and this is Two Bit da Vinci. Nuclear fusion has been one of the holy grails of energy since it was first discovered 100 years ago, and it's what actually powers the stars. It's a type of nuclear reaction that naturally happens under the extreme conditions at a star's core, taking light atoms like hydrogen and combining or fusing them into larger, heavier atoms like helium. You might not know this, but this is actually how all the atoms in the universe, except hydrogen, originally formed, which means that at a very real way, we are literally made out of stardust. Something to think about. Anyway, fusion energy means taking the power of a star and putting it into a reactor right here on Earth. While this may seem like science fiction, we may be closer to it than ever before. There are several reasons why many people believe that fusion is the future of energy. First, fusion is the single most energy-dense and powerful source of energy we know of, releasing 4 to 8 million times more energy than burning an equal mass of fossil fuels, and 4 times more energy than uranium-235 released in a conventional nuclear reactor. Second, the fuel for fusion energy is abundant. Most current approaches to fusion energy use two special forms of hydrogen called deuterium and tritium. About 1 in 6,400 hydrogen atoms is a deuterium atom, which means that it makes up about 0.0035% of water by mass. This works out to roughly 40 trillion metric tons of deuterium in the oceans alone, making it a virtually inexhaustible resource. Tritium, on the other hand, is pretty rare, but we can produce it from lithium in nuclear reactors. Third, fusion is considered a clean and completely carbon-free source of energy, since the reaction products are helium, which is harmless, and neutrons, which aren't harmless but can be absorbed to generate power or more tritium. Also, as we mentioned in previous videos and many of you pointed out, helium is actually in a bit of a shortage right now, and helium has some really interesting properties like the specific heat and other thermal considerations that make it really valuable in engineering applications. So if we could produce helium here on Earth, not only would that be really awesome for kids' birthday parties, but amazing for engineering and science. Fourth, unlike nuclear fission, fusion is inherently safe, and there's no chance of a runaway reaction or meltdown. So fusion is a safe, plentiful, clean, and powerful source of energy. Tackling it would mean the rapid decarbonization of the world economy, providing a reliable and sustainable source of baseload power to complement renewables. It would also mean energy independence for countries around the world. For you and I, that would mean no more spiking utility bills whenever a new conflict pops up overseas, among a multitude of other benefits. So naturally, the question is, if it's so great, why aren't we using it everywhere? The answer is simple. We haven't been able to make it work in a technically and economically viable way. But the recent breakthroughs at the Lawrence Livermore National Laboratories takes us one step closer in the right direction. Now, to understand the magnitude of this new development, we need to put things into context. So let's start with how fusion works. You may remember from high school chemistry that all atoms are made of a tiny positive nucleus surrounded by negative electrons. In order for two atoms to fuse, we need to strip them of their electrons and get their nuclei close enough together for them to bond through a special type of force called strong nuclear force, which is the strongest force in the universe, by the way. We can use different types of atoms as fuel, but the most promising options use deuterium and tritium, which are types of hydrogen atoms, and a special isotope of helium called helium-3. Now you're probably wondering, where does fusion energy actually come from? And the answer to that is when fusion occurs, a part of the mass of the atoms is converted into energy. The amount of energy is given by Einstein's most famous equation, E equals mc squared. For example, if we took 2 grams of deuterium and fused it with 3 grams of tritium, they would produce around 4 grams of helium and 1 gram of neutrons, and it would convert 0.018883 grams into pure energy. Yes, energy and mass are related. The mass represents 1.7 trillion joules of energy, or 472 million watt hours. And that's from burning just 5 grams of fuel. That's enough to power the average American home for 44.4 years, or to charge 4,500 Model S performance Teslas. This works out to a specific energy density of almost 100 billion watt hours per kilogram. 300 million times higher than the best lithium-ion battery, 7 million times higher than gasoline, and 4 times higher than uranium-235. Oh, looks like my package is ready to pick up at Best Buy.
Wait, did somebody say Best Buy?
I didn't think he'd hear me. We love Best Buy. It's like a toy store for big boys, as my son would say. I'm picking up a Garmin Dashcam Mini 2 because a few weeks ago there was a car crash just down my street. Luckily, everyone was okay, and because one of the drivers had a dashcam, there was proof of what happened. I turn to Best Buy because I trust products they carry, much like Garmin. This car key size dashcam is remarkably compact, and with 1080p video and 140-degree lens and Garmin Clarity HDR optics, you'll be able to record high-quality, crisp videos day or night. Plug it into your car and it takes care of the rest, and with incident detection, it saves videos from just before, during, and after an event automatically. It has voice control so you can focus on the road.
Okay, Garmin.
Parking guard that monitors your car for any activity while parked and will even alert you on your phone. And with an online vault, you can even record those files to the cloud to share on your terms. Live View even allows you to see what's happening around your car in real time. I love this feature. I went to Best Buy and got a Garmin for my dash cam because there are two brands I know, love, and trust. Keep yourself protected as you drive with the Garmin Dashcam Mini 2 from Best Buy. Links in the description. Huge thanks to Best Buy and you for supporting the show. Just 1 gram of fuel would be enough to cover the average person's lifetime use of energy, and we could find it in just 3 gallons of water and 3 or 4 standard laptop batteries. I don't know about you, but the idea of being able to carry all the fuel I'll ever need in just a couple of water bottles and a few laptop batteries feels unreal. But of course, fusion energy isn't perfect. The big problem is that the nuclei are all very small and they repel each other with the second strongest force in the universe, electromagnetic repulsion, which gets stronger as the nuclei get closer together. Like when you try to stick two magnets of opposite poles closer. Because of this repulsion and their small size, we need to compress and confine atoms to extremely high pressures, densities, and temperatures and keep them like that long enough for fusion to occur. Otherwise, they'll just bounce apart again. In other words, we literally have to recreate the conditions inside the core of a star to get fusion going. Not an easy task by any means, and something that takes a lot of energy to pull off. And that's where things start looking grim for fusion energy. Even though fusion releases a tremendous amount of energy, we have never been able to get enough fusion reactions to occur to produce more energy than we put into it to make the fusion happen in the first place. And that's exactly what changed last December at Lawrence Livermore National Labs, when they achieved ignition using the world's largest laser, the National Ignition Facility, or NIF. In short, igniting a plasma means making the fuel fuse to release at least as much energy as it took to make the fusion happen in the first place. It's the same idea as igniting a branch to start a campfire. You know that the combustion releases heat, but you still need to use a lighter or friction or some other source of energy to get that fire reaction started. And using that same analogy, even if you are able to make a small spark in that wood, you wouldn't manage to actually ignite it until you produced enough heat to make the branch catch on fire. The same thing applies with a nuclear fusion reactor. Unless we manage to get at least as much energy out as we put in, we won't be able to keep the reactor burning the fuel by itself. It took 60 years, but we finally made it happen. So how did they do it? Well, there are dozens of different designs and approaches to nuclear fusion. The most popular approach is using magnets to confine hot plasma and to compress it into high temperatures and high densities. The most common application of this magnetic confinement technology are tokamaks, like the huge ITER project that's currently under construction. Other technologies include spiralmaks, stellarators, and a promising field reverse configuration reactor from a company called Helion Energy. But success came from a different type of reactor that uses lasers to produce something called inertial confinement fusion, or ICF. In ICF, the deuterium-tritium fuel is introduced in a small spherical capsule or shell around 4 millimeters wide, usually made of diamond, which is far smoother than a mirror. That's just about the size of a BB pellet or a peppercorn. The capsule is suspended inside a little hollow cylinder called a holrom, about 10 millimeters in diameter and 20 millimeters long, usually made of gold, which is cooled to cryogenic temperatures. So from there, a pulse of 192 high energy lasers are shot into the walls of the holrom, generating X-rays that quickly heat the outside of the capsule like a tiny X-ray oven, vaporizing the outer shell. As the capsule material shoots out like a million little rockets, the fuel is pushed in, following Newton's law of inertia, imploding to 1/10,000th of its initial volume. The fuel then heats up to more than 270 million degrees Fahrenheit at pressures twice that of the center of the sun. And under these conditions, the pulse of 192 laser beams deposited a total of 2.05 megajoules of energy into the walls of the hall room. For context, 2.5 million joules may sound like a lot, but in reality, that's only about the energy in two chocolate bars. However, that energy is released by the laser in a very short burst, and it only lasts a few billionths of a second, generating a peak power of 500 terawatts for a very small period of time. For that brief moment, the laser power exceeded the entire United States 2022 average power generation of 460 terawatts. If you're wondering how they pulled this off without leaving the nation in a blackout, it's pretty simple. Capacitors. Hundreds of thousands of capacitors connected in series and parallel. If you want to know how capacitors work and why they can deliver so much power, we made a video on supercapacitors a few months ago that we'll link here. A good video to check out after this one. During the laser's pulse, a little plasma 0.1 millimeter in diameter forms, which for a trillionth of a second is the brightest thing on Earth. The nuclear fusion reactor releases a total of 3.15 megajoules of energy, resulting in a yield of 1.54 times the energy deposited by the laser, meaning that for the first time, we have a net gain of more than 50%. Fusion power, baby. So we basically managed to explode a tiny thermonuclear atomic bomb the size of a peppercorn using lasers and created a true tiny little star in a lab. And if that's not science fiction turned reality enough, I don't know what is. So does that mean we pulled it off? I mean, fusion is now right around the corner, right? We're gonna start seeing them popping up. Not really. In fact, not by a long shot. This is an important milestone, for sure. But it's just that, a milestone, in a very long and arduous path with many obstacles on the horizon. Even though it took over 60 years to reach it, the only thing the milestone proves is that it is possible to produce more energy from fusion than what you put in. But there's so much more that still has to happen for fusion energy to become a reality. One major challenge is that even though the NIF shot 2.05 megajoules of energy onto the target, it actually sucked 300 megajoules from the grid for a wall plug efficiency of just 0.7%. You don't have to be a rocket scientist to tell that investing 300 megajoules to produce 3.15 megajoules back isn't generating electricity, it's consuming it. Even worse, we can't really use the full 3.15 megajoules that the fusion produced. We'd still need to capture that energy and convert it into electricity or other form of usable energy, each step having its particular inefficiencies depending on what technology we end up using. Then comes the capsules. These capsules are made in collaboration with a German company called Diamond Materials, and they have to be perfectly rounded and virtually defect-free. Every time. Any tiny imperfection the size of a bacteria can mess up the entire implosion, so they take a long time to make and will cost a lot. Right now, each of the new capsule designs takes 7 months to make from its inception to design to the actual construction and characterization. Even assembling the finished capsule with fuel and getting it ready for the experiment takes 2 weeks. So firing capsules repeatedly to produce any usable amount of energy simply isn't possible today. It doesn't make sense to talk about a levelized cost of energy yet, since this is a research facility, not a commercial power plant. For those reasons, this technology is nowhere near becoming economically viable because of the high cost of operating the largest laser in the world, making nearly perfect fuel capsules and destroying a hallram made of gold with every shot. It's obvious that there's still a ton of work to do, and that you shouldn't be misled into thinking that laser-driven fusion reactors are right around the corner. But this experiment did generate a ton of data that will help us get the next shot better than the last, and that'll help us push closer and closer to a future with nuclear fusion energy. The NIF laser is decades old, and scientists believe that with new laser technologies, they can get the wall plug efficiency up to as much as 33%, delivering 100 megajoules of energy per pulse. All else equal, that would produce over 150 megajoules of energy, and it's still a lot less than about 50% overall, but it's much better than the present loss of 99%. There's also lots of room for improvement in the overall yield. Since the December's experiment, only 4% of the fuel was burned, so there's a potential to increase the amount of energy up to about 25-fold, and they can do that with a more energetic and powerful laser. With these improvements in the laser itself and the capsule design and symmetry, scientists at the Lawrence Livermore Laboratories believe they will eventually reach a net energy gain and be able to start thinking about the next stage of their research, delivering that net energy back to the grid. If nothing else, this milestone proves that given we could ignite a capsule in a lab, we might be able to do the same thing in a power plant, and that's worth looking into. I'm not gonna lie, when I first saw this article, I was really pumped. I was thinking for the first time, we produce more than we put in. Doesn't that mean that fusion is right around the corner? Because I mean, even if it's not a whole lot, we'll just make a bunch of them and just keep powering the next and keep getting more and more power out. But as you can imagine, the cost of the world's biggest laser and all the capacitors to power it for that instant of a second, it's massive. And these are not going to scale up anytime soon. So yes, this is a huge breakthrough. And one, honestly, I'm pretty impressed happened in 2022. If you told me when would this happen, I would have guessed 5 years from now. It put another way, we're 5 years ahead of where I thought we might be. Now, how far are we from seeing a nuclear fusion reactor? It's hard to say. 5-10 years probably is a fair assessment. But what do you guys think? How important is this? Do they have the right approach with ICF? Are there other alternatives that you can think of that might be better? Are you excited about nuclear fusion? Because here's the reason why this matters. Solar power is cheaper. There's been some discussions about why even invest in this when we have solar and wind. Solar is dirt cheap now. It's an easy way to make power, but it doesn't produce power 24 hours a day. Well, not unless you do the Japanese laser solar farm in space idea that we covered video in the description. But other than that, you would need batteries. So for every solar power at every plant you produce, you got to produce batteries to store it at night. This is baseload power. You could run a fusion reactor all day, and the byproduct would be helium, which is vitally important for all sorts of engineering applications. Helium is a great use when you need to store energy in thermal heat. It can store way more heat than natural air or nitrogen or oxygen or anything else, and it's in short supply. So this is important for so many reasons, and I think knowing that this research is happening, especially so close to home, is pretty amazing. And I think I'll just keep checking out the progress and we'll make future videos. So you should be excited. This is a huge breakthrough, but let's pump the brakes. We're not building nuclear fusion power plants anytime soon. All right, that is a look at nuclear fusion and this really important breakthrough that just happened. Hopefully you guys learned a couple things. Write to us, leave a comment, let us know what you think, and let us know what future videos you want to see from us. All right, I'm Ricky with Two Bit da Vinci. We'll catch you next week.